Good afternoon, class. We are in the discussion of reductance to factors. In the previous discussions, we have gone with the reductance to scales, increasing reductance to scale, decreasing reductance to scale, and constant reductance to scale. For that, I have given you the example also. I will repeat once again that example. What is it? So, for example, if I have a capital of if I have a capital of 1 lakh rupees, sorry, I have given you the example of the agriculture, right? If I have an capital of 10,000 rupees, and if I have 3 workers in my hand, and they are working for me to produce the output, say some paddy. Okay, so that means my capital is 10,000 rupees and number of workers in my hand is working for me is 3. By that I am able to produce, say, some the land is constant only here. That means, say, some 4 acres of land, for example. If I am able to produce 40 bags of paddy, for example, for 4 acres with 3 members of labor with a capital of 10,000 rupees, if I am able to produce, say, some 10 bags of paddy, what I do is I will double the capital. Instead of 10,000, now I am having a capital of 20,000, and I will also double the labor. That is, instead of 3, now it is 6. So actually, previously I have only 10 bags of paddy. Now it is, generally when I have doubled it, the output also has to be doubled. That means it has to be 20 only, but unfortunately it is around 24 bags of paddy. I produced 24 bags of paddy now. That means, so now 24 bags minus 10 bags, 24 bags minus 10 bags is 14. Okay, you can see that it is greater than the 100%, right? If the bag, if the bags I have produced is 20, it is 100% raise. I have produced more than that, that is 14. Okay, that means about totally it is around 24 bags of paddy. So that is nothing but increasing returns to the scale, right? Do you get now? When I double, that means I increased the input by 100%. That means doubling means 100% I increased my capital, and 100% I increased my labor. But the increase in the output is more than 100%. So that is nothing but increasing returns to scale. In the similar fashion, if I double the capital once again, that is 4. Instead of 2, now it is 4. And if I double the labor, now it is 12. Okay. And once again, I increased, if the output is around, say, before it is 24, right? Okay. So now, if it increases, instead of 24, if my output is 48 bags, what I am doing, I am comparing with the previous output only, not the starting one. Do you get now? So I am comparing with the previous output only. What is my previous output? My previous output is 24 bags of paddy. Now, when I get the 24 bags of paddy, what are my inputs? 20,000 as capital and 6 workers has given us the 24 bags of paddy. Now it is 48 bags of paddy. So then the output is doubled by increasing my inputs, capital and labor. So that is nothing but constant returns to the scale. Why we are calling it as constant returns to the scale? Yes, the inputs has increased in same fashion, the output has increased in the same proportion, it has increased. So it is called as constant returns to the scale. Decreasing returns to the scale. What is decreasing returns to the scale? So I have increased once again the input. That means instead of now my capital is around 80,000. So first one is 10,000, second one is 20,000, next one is 40,000. Okay. And now it is for, say some, I once again doubled my capital and once again I doubled my labor. And now I have, my output has to be doubled. Okay, instead of 48, it should be around 48 into 2. Say some 96 bags of paddy actually. By increase, by doubling the capital and doubling the labor, my production, that means the output has to be around 96 bags of paddy. But unfortunately, it is around only 80. Okay, I have increased the capital by 100%, that is doubled, and I have increased my labor also by 100%, that is doubled, but my output is not doubled. It is less than the double value. That is not 100%. So it has to be around 96, but it is only 80. That is called as law of decreasing returns to the scale. Okay. That is the returns to the scale. Then we also have the returns to the factors. Returns to the factors. So generally these returns to factors are also called as factor productivities. Okay. Generally, the productivity is nothing but the ratio of output to the input. Okay. Productivity is nothing but the ratio of output to the input. Right. So as we increase the output, the input has to be increased. That means the output will be in the numerator and the input will be in the denominator. Both the values has to be increased. Both the input value, if we increase the input value, automatically there should be increase in the output value. Okay, that thing we have to see here. So generally these factors returns to the factors will be with respect to the short run relationships of the input and the outputs. Okay. So the productivity of one unit of a factor of production will be equal to the output it can generate. Okay. So the changes in the productivity can be measured in terms of, you see here, the changes in the productivity can be measured in terms of total productivity, the average productivity and marginal productivity. So what are these terms? So as there is increase in the inputs, if there is improvement in the total output, okay, then we call it as total productivity. You see, we can have the definitions like this. The total output generated at a varied levels of inputs of a particular factor, while other factors remaining constant, is called as total productivity. Okay. And sometimes they are giving as a total fiscal product. Okay. Total productivity means we want to improve the total productivity. Okay, that means I am increasing the input. I am increasing the input such a way that my total productivity has to be increased. What is this total productivity? That means the number of products, physical products coming out has to be improved, right? Okay. So what is this average productivity? This is nothing but the total productivity divided by the number of units of that particular factor yields the average productivity. And one more thing we have to keep in mind. Producing of a product is not at is important. Not only that, when we talk regarding the productivity, we also has to maintain the quality. So when we can say that we have a good productivity of a good productivity of that particular company will be depending upon the quality of products it is going to produce and the quantity of the products it is going to produce. So just we have discussed regarding the marginal productivity. Marginal productivity is just comparing the just previous outputs. Okay, that is nothing but the marginal productivity. Coming to the economies and diseconomies of scale, we have different types of economies and diseconomies of scale. Okay, first one are internal economies, and we also have external economies also. Okay, economy, when we go with the economies of scale, we have internal economies and external economies, and also diseconomies also. So when we go with the internal economies, it refers to the economies in the production costs, which accurate to the firm alone when it expands its outputs. Okay, when we talk regarding the internal economies, which is referring to the economies in the production cost, economies in the production costs, which acquire to the firm alone when it expands its output. Okay, the internal economies occur as a result of increasing the scale of production. Internal economy, when do the internal economy occurs? It is due to the increase in the scale of production. Okay, so see here, we have different types of internal economies. Manager economies. What we want to say is internal economies means we, as a part of the company, to reduce the selling price of the particular product. Generally, the selling price will be depending upon the costs. Okay, cost in the sense whatever the amount we have invested on it to produce that particular product, it is called as the total thing, are called as costs. Okay, we should have some profit. Okay, so we should have some profit, or sometimes with zero profit also we used to produce the products, we'll sell the products. Okay, so for manufacturing some particular product, we invested some amount of money and time. Okay, the total thing is, say, some the total cost. We want to reduce this total cost. How to reduce this total cost? Okay, that is nothing but the internal economies. Okay, if you reduce the total cost, we can reduce the total selling price. Automatically that particular product can reach more number of customers, and we can have a good market. Okay, so in the internal economies, you can see manager economies. Okay, so every time we used to see that a firm requires a qualified manager personnel to handle each of the functions. Manager economies means generally a company keeps a person who is talented enough to reduce the costs, and also they will be have faith in the person who is bringing the profits to the company. Okay, they will believe in the person who are able to manage all the resources such as marketing, finance, production, human resources, and other one, and in a professional way, who can deal all these type of activities. The company will be in trust of those persons only. Okay, we can see that clearly. You can see, so as an example, you can see here, who is the CEO of Google? Who is the CEO of Google at present? Anyone can answer, right? Satya Nadella, right? Satya Nadella, who is from Telugu states, I think. Okay, he joined as an employee in a company. He worked for his company. Later, he shifted to different types of companies. Might be, we don't know exactly. He might have joined as an employee in a company in the starting stage. He improved himself and he has gone to some prestigious company called as Google. He joined directly as a Google, as an employee in the Google. Then he became the CEO of that particular company, chief executive officer, chief executive officer, right? That means if there may be some n number of employees, there may be some n number of employees, there may be any number of employees, and they will be observing how they are working, how are they talented enough or not. If they are talented enough, they will get a promotion, and they will, the company will be kept in the hand to the persons who are talented enough only. Okay, so managerial economics, that means he must be able to manage the, all the activities such as marketing, finance, production, human resources. Human resources means the employees, in a professional way. Okay, that means the manager plays a very, very important role in internal economies. That means reducing the cost internally of a particular product. Okay, next, commercial economies. So commercial economies comes in different stages. So buying and selling of raw materials and other operating supplies. That means we, if you produce a product, you must be able to sell that particular product commercially. Okay, if the Bill Gates think of designing the new Windows system and keeping for his own, doesn't make money for him. Do you get now? He has to, he in the sense his employees will be developing that operating system or new apps, and that has to be sold commercially, then only the company will be getting the profits, right? That is nothing but commercial economies. That means supplying the products economical way, in economical way. You can see like this regarding this commercial economies. If you are in need of, say, some 20 tons of iron, so if you have a company which is where you manufacture some bike, and you require 20 tons of iron, so if I call to some iron providing company, some agency, and if they say that no sir, if you order only 20 tons of iron, we will charge you the transportation charges. Okay, and if they say that if you order us 30 tons of iron, we will ship it freely for you. Okay, do you get the case? So if you order 20 tons of iron, you use yourself, we has to pay the shipping charges. Generally what you will be doing, you too will be do this economy, commercial economies, you too will be doing this economy. If you order a particular item in an Amazon, if it is less than 500 rupees, you have to pay the shipping charge if you are not a Prime member, or else if you are a Prime member also, mostly you have to pay the shipping charges. That's the reason when you see in the commercial website, when the product cost is less than 500 and range, they will be imposing some shipping charges. If your total order is more than that 500 rupees, you will get free shipping. The same thing you are observing here in the commercial economies also. To transport your item from one place to another place, we have to see that it has to be done in an economical way. We want to reduce the transportation cost also. Okay, next, financial economies. Okay, financial economies means when you run a company, definitely we require some amount of money. okay, that too, that money may be used to pay the salaries of the employees or wages of the labor, or else some other activity, that too buy the raw material, some other for transportation, this type of things. So we have to see, as a manager we have to see that which company is giving you for the lowest rate of interest. You have to observe that, and you should try to get from them. If you are eligible enough, you will get that loan or from that particular financial company. Okay, so financial economies, you should also see that we are buying, that means we are getting some financial support from other companies by paying the interest. So as a manager, as a person, you'll be knowing that paying more interest is not a good thing. So first we try of getting it at a low cost, at low interest rate, we will be trying to get that loan or else financial support. Okay. As a part, you should be able to know that, as a manager, you should be able to know that. Technical economies also. Okay. So technical economies means, sometime we are unable to get workers, general labor, we are unable to get general labor. At that particular point of time, what we will be doing, we will be using the machinery. Okay, if machinery is not available, we will be using the manpower, that is workers, labor. And if possible, we should be able to use both in such a way that we decrease our cost. Okay, our main agenda here is economies, in the sense we want to try to reduce the cost of a product, if it is a product based company, of our service. Okay, if it is a service based company. Okay, technical economies, that are the technical economies. Here also one more thing we have to keep in mind, there will be work for the technical person, there will be work for the non-technical person. We have to keep them in correct position. The person for doing non-technical work, a person who is not studied more is sufficient. So technical person has to be used in correct area. Okay, we can't assign this technical person to the non-technical work. What happens if we assign? We are paying more amount as salary to this technical person. For a non-technical person, we are paying less amount of salary or wages. Okay, so we should not use like that. Okay, sometimes it is necessary for us risk-bearing economies. Risk-bearing economies means, so if we have produced some amount of product, some huge amount of product you have produced, and you should take proper care of that particular product. It has to be kept in a good godown, okay, and which is having proper fire safety, and also you have to take the insurance of the particular product. Okay, do you get now? So risk bearing economies, that means you have to take the insurance of the product what you have produced. If you have done a mistake, that if you have not taken the insurance, suddenly if any fire accident or else any other case, any other thing uneven had happened to it, that particular product, what you will do? Okay, there will be a huge loss to the company. That means risk bearing economies, we have to pay some insurance also to your products what you have produced. Okay, so you can see here, if you have produced some, if you see any of the company, motorcycle manufacturing company, bike manufacturing company, they will be producing some goods and they will be keeping them in a godown, and they will insure those bikes before the customer buys that particular product. Also, they will, that bikes are having some insurance. If not, what happens while shifting those bikes from one place to another place, or else if it is kept in the godown itself, sometimes the fire action may take, or else some other natural calamity may take place, and the total thing may be destroyed. Okay, so definitely we have to take this risk bearing economies. So in English we have this saying that has a don't keep all the eggs in one basket. Okay, don't keep all the eggs in one basket. That means if any risk takes place, if that particular basket is having some problem, or if that particular basket has fallen down, total eggs will be smashed. So generally we have to keep your eggs in different places. That means that is the concept of economy. Okay, you will be learning it later. Okay, indivisibilities and automated machinery. Indivisibilities and automated machinery means so this thing we have already discussed previously. When in a company, so we have different types of machineries. For producing 500 number of units, we require machine A, which is a small one. Its cost is also less. Okay, that means we are by using machine A per day, we are able to produce 500 number of units. So in at present time, we are getting only for 20 working days, we are able to produce 500 into 20 by 2 are 10 and 500 two zeros and zero, say some 10,000 I think. Okay, for a month we are able to produce only 10,000 number of units of output. So later, if our product is very well and good, if we are getting a 20,000 number of, sorry, more than 20,000, say some 30,000 number of units order, what we will do first is we will improve the working hours to produce that 30,000 number of product with the same machine A. Still we are getting more number of orders, say some 60,000 number of products order we are getting. If we continuously get such type of orders for 2 or 3 months, that machine A will not be useful for us to produce that sufficient amount of products. So we have to go and buy some other machine, say some B, okay, which will be able to produce 80,000 number of units per day. Sorry, yes, okay, 80,000 number of units per month. But I am required only 60,000 number of units per month. But I can't divide that particular machine. Okay, I can't divide that particular machine, and I can't buy a part of it. I will be buying that particular product only with 80,000 number of, which is able to produce 80,000 number of goods per month, and I will be supplying these products to the required persons, and rest of the products will be kept in the godown. And when the order has been increased, when the order is increased, I will be supplying those products also. That is called as indivisibilities and automated machinery. Okay, I can't make half. Okay, and also one more thing, if your company is in loss, we can't get half manager. You have to pay full salary to the manager also to maintain that particular company. Even though if you are having some loss, we can't get persons, half person or half manager. So we have to maintain them. That is called as indivisibilities. Okay, we can't divide those. So economies of larger dimension. So that's the example what I have said just now. Automated machinery means we are producing, to improve our productivity, we are introducing some new type of machinery. And indivisibilities. Okay, we can divide something, say some telephone, we can't break it and for our uses, so we have to maintain it. Economics of research and development. What is this economics of research and development? Generally, economics of research and development is nothing but so you see here, large organizations such as Dr. Reddy's Labs, Hindustan Lever, spend heavily on the research and development and bring the output out several innovative products. Only such firms with a strong R&D base can cope with the competition globally. So what we have to do is, in the R&D also, we have to follow some economies. That means maintaining the person who are talented enough, maintaining them with some medium range of salaries. Likewise, and generally what happens is, small companies will be there, some 4 or 5 or 10 companies which are very small, they will collaborate with each other.
ఒట్టం ఇలా చూద్దాం అనుకున్నా నా మీదట్టుగా లేక లేక అన్నా.
ఓకే, so generally some small companies will collaborate with each other, they will coordinate with each other, and they will form, these 10 companies will be form one research R&D cell to improve their products. Okay, they can't maintain individually this total R&D cell, it costs more for each company. So what they do is, they, for reducing this R&D cost, what they do is, they will collaborate with some group and they will get to the main content. It means the R&D will be going on. If there is no R&D, if there is no improvement in your product, no one is going to buy further. Okay, so external economies also, we have different types of external economies. Economies of concentration. Okay, so economies of concentration, that means to improve the product. That means, if I keep in an area where there is no proper road, my products, while going from one place to another place, they get damaged easily. So that means they have, the company should be nearby some approach road. Okay, then only I can transfer my goods from one place to another place easily without getting damaged. Okay, so firms are located one place, unlikely there is better infrastructure in terms of approach roads, transportation facilities such as railways lines. And you can see, you can observe, when you go when you come from Hyderabad to Vijayawada by train, you can see on the right side, you can see many number of cement companies are power generating companies. Why? Because when you come by train, means there will, nearby you can have a train facility. That means a railway track will be there, and a goods train can directly go into the company itself and unload the total content. That means the raw material, and they get unloaded there and they can come back. Do you get now? That means economies of concentration is very important. The transportation, okay, even the railway lines also very, very important for your companies. Okay, so generally, if the products go by road, it will be costing more. If they go by railways, it will be less. And we can observe that some costly cars will be moving from one place to another place in the trains only. And also you can also see some military vehicles are moving on trains from one place to another place. Okay, if they go by road, it is some risk and also it is costing more. Okay, so that are from external economies of concentration. Economies of R&D, that what we have said now, very few companies will be having their own R&D. So some of them will be maintaining this R&D with the collaboration with some other companies. okay, economies of welfare. Okay, you can see this thing, it is very much clear in the bikes. You can see previously, so Kawasaki Bajaj, that means Kawasaki is some other country company, right? Kawasaki is some other country company. Now you are seeing some sports bikes of Kawasaki only. Okay, the other one is the Bajaj. Bajaj is Indian company, right? It has collaborated with the Kawasaki, with the combinedly has gone with the R&D, and also they have sold some bikes. Later it has changed, right? Later it has Bajaj came in separate. Previously it is Hero Honda, right? Hero Honda. Hero is generally a cycle manufacturing company, and Honda is some company from other country which is able to manufacture the engines, right? So Hero collaborated with the Honda, and we got the Hero Honda bikes. So later they discontinued the collaboration, right? Honda itself directly coming into the market with some bikes. Hero is still having some, producing some bikes, right? That means they collaborated with one another, and they helped each other in the R&D in producing the new varieties of bikes. So economies of welfare, in the sense, not only, okay, if the industrial, if you have an industry and the workers has to come from very, very longer distances, it takes some time for them, or else you generally the industry will be away from the town. Okay, if you don't maintain a canteen, they will be going out. If you don't maintain the toilets in your factory for the workers, they have to go out to home. So that means there is huge amount of time wasted. So you have to provide some facilities within the company itself. Okay. So that is nothing but the welfare of economies. Okay, some of the colleges, generally you can see this IITs or NITs, or you can also see the Andhra University, where in the university will be having a huge area where you'll be having different branches, such as say different branches of engineering and different branches of arts, different branches of science. Even they have the medical college also. Everything will be in the almost in the same area, and in the same area only the professors quarters will be there. Professors and assistant professors quarters will be there. The faculty quarters will be there. That means what does it mean? Even some of the colleges, such as say some GMR, I think the faculty and faculty houses will also be there within the campus itself. That means to avoid the time wastage. Okay. And in the same area only they will have the schools, they will be having the hospitals, all the students will be having the hostels and all. Okay. In our college also you can see here, in our college itself you can see the, within the campus you can see the boys hostel, within the campus you can see the girls hostel also. If we don't have within the campus, that means we have to if we maintain outside the campus, we have to provide the transportation, or the students has to come with their own transportation. That will be increasing the cost for the student. It will be increasing the cost for the student. So in the similar fashion only, we have to see the regarding the welfare of the students and also regarding the welfare of the employees. So diseconomies of scale means we can't avoid some type of unnecessary wastages. We can't avoid the unnecessary wastages. So that leads to the diseconomies of scale. So generally diseconomies of scale are mostly from the manager in nature. That means the manager or the person or the main key person may not be able to take the decision at the right time, which will be damaging the total company. Okay, diseconomies are mostly managerial in nature. That means keeping an unfit person as a manager, it is managerial problem, right? That is the management problem. Keeping an unfit person in a manager position who is unable to take the decisions properly. And if he takes the wrong decision, the total company has to go into the loss. Don't have proper planning, don't know the proper coordination and communication control. Maybe increasingly complex, okay? So these things may result in the cost per unit, increasing the cost per unit. Automatically we try to sell that one with some profit with higher cost. If it doesn't happen, what we will do, we have to reduce the selling price. And if you make that selling price equal to the cost price, you have invested a huge amount of time, huge amount of R&D time. Okay, even though if you sell that, okay, well and good, you will be going with little amount of loss. If you are unable to sell at least at the cost price, you have to sell that product less than the selling price. Okay, these type of concepts will be there, which will be a problem for you. Okay, by that we have completed this thing. And the topic remaining next in the next class, we will be discussing regarding the cost analysis. Okay.